Okay, I think we are online. Good morning and welcome to all to worship with us on this, the seventh Sunday after Pentecost. God is good all the time, all the time. God is good. I just have a few announcements for you. I know we have some additional announcements, so we'll get to those in a moment. But just a reminder that we do have Bible study and our luncheon this morning following worship. So we hope that you'll all be able to stay afterwards for that. And then tomorrow evening is our monthly council meeting. That'll be 7 o'clock tomorrow evening here at the church. And preceding that is Mutual Ministry Committee at 6 o'clock. So if you have any items for the attention of the Mutual Ministry Committee, if you could please get them to them before that meeting, and if they need to address any of the issues, they can certainly do that. Today, as many of you probably know, is my last day as your official interim. And I just wanted to take a moment just to thank you all for the opportunity to serve you in this capacity. Thank you for inviting me to be a part of your lives for these many, many months. It's been a very much a blessing for me to do so. And I'm certainly going to carry all of memories, a lot of memories, and of course, all of your faces with me in the weeks and months to come. But thank you again for allowing me to serve you as your interim. Just one other announcement with regards to hospitalizations. Doreen Pavlokovich should be discharged and back home. Do we know that for sure?
That was the latest I heard.
Yeah, I understood that when I saw her late this past week. So she may very well be at home at this point. And when I did see her, she said she was feeling better in her hip where she had fractured her hip. So that's also good news. So we want to continue to keep her in thought and prayer as she continues to heal. Those are all the announcements that I have. I'm going to turn it over to Carol and Jenny at this time.
Thank you. And also reiterate, since this is Pastor Joel's last week, we're going to miss him. He's endeared himself to the congregation, and we all just want to wish him well. Mm-hmm. And there'll be, like I said, a reception with a light lunch after church. I also wanted to say the flowers on the altar today were donated by Becky Rensel in honor of her daughter Jean's birthday. So thank you, Becky. Council has been very busy on several fronts this summer. Some councils take the summer off. It seems like ours is getting busier. So we have been working still to have a joint agreement with Mount Zion Church in Churchtown. And our goal, our end goal, is to have a called, ordained minister that would serve both congregations. Of course, that means having a call committee, which you all know takes a while. So it would be a joint call committee. And if anybody's interested in being on a call committee, please let me know. We would have a joint, like I said, so there'll probably be two or three members on this call committee from each congregation. And I would love some volunteers for that. while pastor's last day is today, we will have supply pastors for the month of July. August is yet to be determined. During that interim, of particularly July, if there's any emergencies, please call me. I have the list of pastors that will we could refer to for pastoral emergencies. So please call me. The office is open Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday from 9 to 2, so you can always call Susanna. And she can help also with calling me or letting me know what's going on. The other thing is our finances are pretty stable, I hear, for this month. We don't have the exact report yet. We're holding still, so that's a good thing. And then finally, last week we had a meeting with a group called Safe Harbor, which provides affordable, low-income housing. And they have a project going in Carlisle right now called Safe Harbor Village. And they're looking to continue this type of outreach. So we were interested in that because we would love to have affordable housing put on our lot over here, the field and the property behind the parking lot. So that's something we're investigating right now. We're excited, but there's other things we investigate too. So we're in that project of still getting research done of getting something done with that field and area. So if there's any questions, please don't hesitate to ask me or any council member. Thank you.
Morning from Youth and Family.
Morning.
So just a reminder that our next Fuse meeting will be on July 21st, and that is for any youth that may attend, 0 to 18, so that doesn't have to be a member of the church, so that could be anybody you want to bring. It could be a neighbor, it could be a niece, nephew, anybody that wants to come, and any supportive adult that they want to bring with them is welcome to come as well. So we're going to have the pictures from the senior high summer camp are going to be in the Google Drive. You're going to see the link to that coming out this week. So look for that in the email that goes out every Wednesday. So you're going to see a lot of good pictures in there from what we did during the summer camp. You'll see probably some extra surprises in there too. You'll also get to see a little bit of a feed of our dance class that was in there. So if you're interested in learning how to do the Charleston, you'll be able to see some of the lesson that we got to learn how to do, and even maybe even teach yourself how to do that. You're also going to find a link in there. So Austin and I will be traveling as of next Saturday. We will be leaving to go to New Orleans for the National Youth Gathering, and we will be down there for a week. We're going to be spending the first couple days doing mission work down there. We're going to be rebuilding the coral reef for the New Orleans, and we're going to be helping out with their national disaster relief kits and doing some other help that they've already started. We're going to be assisting them with that work. And then we'll be going over to the National Youth Gathering then for the rest of the week. Each night they do a mass gathering down there in the Smoothie King Center with 14,000 other youth from across the country. So it is a very big gathering, but they do have a live link that if you guys are interested in seeing what we are experiencing, you are able to log into that and actually view it yourselves. So that you will find a link in that email that goes out on Wednesday. If you log in during the live time, you can watch it for free, but if you do want to see the recording, you do have to pay for it. So I encourage you to log in while it is going on so that you can watch it for free and see what we are doing while we are down there. So aside from that, just pay attention to the other announcements that are in the email, pay attention to the signups, and make sure you sign up for the other activities that we have going. Thank you much.
Okay. Thank you, Jenny. Thank you, Carol. Are there any other additional announcements? Anything we missed? No? Okay. Then I invite you to recite with me our mission statement as printed in our bulletin. We respond to Christ's love by feeding those who hunger in body, mind, and spirit. Let us prepare our hearts then now for worship.
Thank you.
I invite the congregation at this time to please stand with me as we have our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy. Amen. Amen. Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us. It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life and feed us for life in the world. Amen. Beloved people of God, in Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. Let us sing then our opening hymn, hymn number 796. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Have mercy on us, Lord, and hear our solemn prayer. We come to hear your living word. It saves us from despair. Wash away our sin, pour out your grace and make us whole, that new life may begin. Have mercy on us, Lord, make sin and shame depart, renew us with your saving power, create in us new.
And we sing together our canticle of praise.
And pray. to save us. Now you reign at God's right hand. Hear our prayer, restore, forgive us. In your promise firm we stand. Holy One, we now acclaim you, Lord, alone to you we call. Holy One, in faith we name you, God most high and near to all. Jesus Christ with God the Spirit, in the Father's splendor bright.
Let us pray together the prayer of the day. God of the covenant, in our baptism, you call us to proclaim the coming of your kingdom. Give us the courage you gave the apostles, that we may faithfully witness to your love and peace in every circumstance of life. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may please be seated for the readings.
First lesson is a reading from Ezekiel, the second chapter. A voice said to me, "No mortal, stand on your feet, and I will speak with you." And when he spoke to me, a spirit entered into me and set me on my feet, and I heard him speaking to me. He said to me, "Mortal, I am sending you to the people of Israel, to a nation of rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their ancestors have transgressed against me to this very day. The descendants are impudent and stubborn. I am sending you to them, and you shall say to them, 'Thus says the Lord God,' whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house. They shall know that there has been a prophet among them." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Second lesson is a reading from St. Paul's Epistle to the Corinthians, the 12th chapter. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. Three times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly in my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I'm content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
From the Gospel according to St. Mark, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. On the Sabbath, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astounded. They said, "Where did the man get all this? What is the wisdom, this wisdom that has been given to him? What deeds of power are being done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Prophets are not without honor, except in their hometown and among their own kin and in their own house." And he could do no deed of power there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and cured them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. Then he went about among the villages teaching, and he called the 12 and began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over the unclean spirits. He ordered them to take nothing for their journey except a staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not to put on two tunics. He said to them, "Wherever you enter a house, stay there until you leave the place. If any place will not welcome you and they refuse to hear you, as you leave, shake the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them." So they went out and proclaimed that all should repent. They cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and cured them. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Congregation, may please be seated. Sisters and brothers in Christ, let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, for you are our strength, and you are most certainly our Redeemer. Amen. So, sisters and brothers in Christ, today's gospel reading is about evangelism. And when we hear that word evangelism, we probably cringe, maybe shudder, squirm in our seats. Why? Well, because most of us are probably uncomfortable with the idea of evangelism. Most of us probably want nothing to do with evangelism. If it means engaging other people around the topic of God, if it means talking about our faith, if it means asking people what they believe, most of us want none of that. You just don't talk about such things in casual conversation, right? Makes people uncomfortable, it makes us uncomfortable. And so when I say evangelism, we either tune out or shut down or become completely catatonic. But Jesus won't let us off so easy. Indeed, Jesus called his 12 closest disciples and sent them out two by two. And so I don't know why we think that we can avoid talking about and doing evangelism. Now, our word evangelism actually comes from the Greek euangelion, which means good news, and it was a word that was actually used in the Roman Empire to speak about the good news associated with the emperor. Indeed, there was an inscription excavated in 1899 called the Priene inscription, and this inscription on stone was found in Priene, an ancient Greek city located in western Turkey. And the inscription details the edict that established the new Roman calendar beginning with the year of Emperor Augustus' birth. Now, a similar inscription has been found in other locations as well, and so it seems that this edict was widely circulated and adopted by the Roman populace. All the provincial calendars across the Roman Empire had to align with this edict. And so what did the inscription in Pyrene say, actually? Well, it said this, bear with me, it's a little long of an inscription. Since Providence, which has ordered all things and is deeply interested in our life, has set in most perfect order by giving us Augustus, whom she filled with virtue that he might benefit all mankind, humankind, sending him as a savior, both for us and for our descendants, and that he might end war and arrange all things, and since he, Caesar, by his appearance, excelled even our anticipations, surpassing all previous benefactors and not even leaving to posterity any hope of surpassing what he has done. And since the birthday of the god Augustus was the beginning of the glad tidings or good news, the Evangelion, for the world that came by reason of him. The inscription ends there. So the term Evangelion was used at the time of the Roman Empire to herald the good news of the arrival of a kingdom, the reign of a king, the emperor, that brought war to an end. So that all people of the world who surrendered and pledged allegiance to this emperor would be granted salvation from destruction. The calendar inscription of Pyrene speaks of the birthday of Emperor Augustus as the beginning of the gospel announcing his kingdom with the Roman edict to start a new calendar system based on the year of Augustus's birth. Now, if we took note as we are hearing that inscription, we see the wording in the inscription is suspiciously similar to the declaration about Jesus the Lord, right? Mark's gospel begins with the word, the beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, Son of God. The Pyrene inscription says the birthday of the God Augustus was the beginning of the good news for the world. The inscription also speaks of Providence giving us Augustus that he might benefit all humankind, sending him as a savior. Words that could be used were used to speak of Jesus. The Gospel of Luke describes an angel of the Lord talking with the shepherds, and the angel says, "Behold, I bring you good news of great joy, for to you is born this day in the city of David a savior who is Christ the Lord." And just as the Pyrene inscription announced a lasting peace with the arrival of Emperor Augustus, the text says Augustus was sent that he might end war, just as the Pyrene inscription announces peace, so did the angels sing of peace to the shepherds in the field, right? Glory to God in the highest and on earth, peace and goodwill among people. So our term evangelism was used actually to speak of the Roman emperor and then was taken over by the early Christians to speak of Jesus the Lord. Now today, we use that word evangelism to speak about sharing the good news of Christ with other people. We evangelize, or we're supposed to anyway, we share the gospel, we share the good news, and so in effect, we could say that we gospelize. But what does evangelism actually look like today? The gospel says the disciples went out on a journey two by two wearing sandals and a tunic, but for us this seems quite archaic. Not to mention, we as evangelists are hardly going to impose upon other people so that those other people put us up for the night or even subsequent nights, as the gospel text seems to allude to. No, times have changed, and the way we do evangelism has changed. And when it comes to evangelism, most of us are really maybe just content making sure that the worship times are publicized well on the marquee out front or on the church's website or on the church's answer machine, that that's enough for evangelism. But some of us may be bold enough to talk with another person about the church that we attend. And that is a very good entree into evangelism. That is to talk about why it is we come to church. Now make note of this then, that we don't have to know a lot about the Bible to evangelize. We don't have to know a lot about church doctrine or church history to evangelize. Indeed, we often make evangelism more daunting than I think it needs to be. It is enough to be able to speak about why it is we come to church, to be able to speak enthusiastically on this topic, why we come to church, for that is a great entrance point into evangelism. Why are we members of this church? What brings us back week after week? Why have we made a commitment to serving here among these people? And so in response to these questions, maybe we talk about community here at St. Stephen. Maybe we talk about the caring and hospitable community here. We talk about the persons who are our siblings in Christ. Maybe we talk about the things we do. For example, the dinner with friends, our community meals, the Eucharistic ministry, the youth events, the trunk and treat event. And in talking about all these things, we express the blessings and joy we experience through this service. Maybe we talk as well about the learning we experience in our Sunday school and in our Bible study, and we note how our everyday lives are the better for it. Yes, we need to be able to talk and talk comfortably about our faith life, which is to say we talk about our church life. We need to be able to articulate why we are part of this congregation should the opportunity present itself. Yes, we need to take advantage of those opportunities to talk about our faith, our church life, when the time comes, and the only way to do that is to have thought out what we would say actually in advance. Or just imagine, if you will, someone is talking with us about their life in general or about their life every day, and that someone says that all sense of community has really suffered because of COVID, or all sense of community has suffered because of technology, that people are on their devices too much, that people do not engage in community anymore. And we can respond by saying, well, that is why I feel so blessed to be a part of a wonderful community. What community is that? The person might respond and say. And we can say the community here at St. Stephen. What's that? What do they do? And voila, there you have it. The opportunity to speak about the church. But the trick, I think, is to have the church in the forefront of our minds, not on some back burner. We need to have our spiel, our sales pitch at the ready. I'm willing to bet that there are numerous occasions where in the course of the day we could have slipped in a conversation about the church with other persons and we didn't do so. And I'm not talking just about being afraid to do so. No, what I'm talking about is that we didn't even see the opportunity because we don't have the church in the forefront of our minds to just launch into talking about it. What would our evangelism look like for us as a church if every day each of us woke up and the very first thing that entered our minds is this prayer? God, make me an instrument of your good news. Help me to see those occasions when I can talk about my faith life, my church life, and when those occasions present themselves, empower me to speak up. Amen. What if we were to pray that every morning? What would happen, do you think? It would probably change us. How? Well, first, it would put evangelism in the forefront of our minds, and if we become diligent about praying this prayer the first thing every morning, how could it do otherwise? Yes, we might need a reminder, a written note by our bedside, maybe a recurring memo on our phone, but with a little practice, it would become our own really personal edict, like the changing of the Roman calendar by the Priene inscription, but it would become our edict by which we live by. Second, praying this prayer would force us to look intentionally for those opportunities to evangelize. You see, if we are praying for God to use us to be an instrument for God's good news and asking God to help us see opportunities to evangelize, well, then we can trust that God will respond. And the way God will respond is by us actually looking for those opportunities. And third, and finally, praying this prayer also forces us to think about what we will say when the opportunity presents itself. Again, if we are praying to God to empower us to speak, well, then we need to have thought in advance about what words we will say. So if we are serious about evangelism, and of course we always need to be so, I think this is the route we need to take. We need to pray about it every day and the first thing every day so that evangelism becomes forefront in our minds, and we need to be on the lookout for evangelism opportunities. And when those opportunities come, we need to be at the ready with the words that we need to say. And I think then if we do these things, maybe, just maybe, we won't find ourselves cringing and shuddering and squirming in our seats whenever the word evangelism is mentioned. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to please stand with me then and let us sing together our hymn of the day, hymn number 576.
Together recite the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. One in the communion of saints and in the power of the Holy Spirit, we join our voices in prayer. Glorious God, you bend down to wash the feet of your disciples. Let the servant church arise in our teaching, our praying, our healing, and our doing. Make all your faithful people powerful in weakness and strong in grace. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Life-giving God, your fingers trace the heavens and your hands mold the earth. Where there is drought, bring nourishing rain. Where there is devastation from fire or flood, bring relief. Sustain the well-being of every living thing. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful God, you speak, and the nations listen. Open those who govern to the cities of all who journey with no food or shelter, particularly people fleeing violence, those seeking freedom, and those in search of community. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, your embrace brings wholeness to those who are troubled. Anoint all who suffer in any way with the oil of healing and grant them renewal. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Welcoming God, in your presence, strangers become companions and enemies become neighbors. Open our doors to those we have so easily shut out, particularly people who are different from us or who are marginalized by church or society. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Are there other prayer requests from the people of God? In your mercy, hear our prayer. God of healing, bring your hope and your healing power especially to these persons as well. Doreen Pavlukovich, Julie Grove, Pastor Jody Ellis, Tom Burson, Dave McLaughlin, Betty Windemaker, Stephen Michael Lee, Kent Clellan, and all those family members and friends for whom our church holds in prayer. We pray for an end to war in this world, especially the Ukraine, the Middle East, and where there is armed conflict. We pray for Bishop Dunlop and for our synod. We pray for United Lutheran Seminary, and we pray for our sisters and brothers at Mount Zion and Our Savior Lutheran Church as they pray for us. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God, our refuge and strength, be with those men and women serving in the military that they may be vigilant in their service. We pray especially for our family members and friends serving in the military such that as they serve to protect our nation, may they be reminded of your constant protection. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Eternal God, you gather us into your house of many dwelling places. We give you thanks for our faithful departed. Inspire us by their lives of faith until with them we rest forever at our journey's end. In your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Holy God, holy and merciful, into your outstretched arms we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in the one who is the way, the truth, and the life, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of that peace with one another, and we ask those who are on Zoom to please turn on our video that we can share the peace with you.
Somebody's waving.
Who's on? Over Stacy.
Mr. Rogers. You're the man.
As we begin to make our way back to our pews, just a gentle reminder, there are a number of ways by which you may make your offering to St. Stephen. There are noted on the back of our bulletin. At this time, then, let us prepare to receive the offering.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, you have set this table with your very self and called us to the feast of plenty. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us in this meal. Make us to be what we receive here, your body for the life of the world. Amen. And this time I invite those that are on Zoom and using the communion packets to prepare their elements as well for communion. One second, Mitchell. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, and he gave thanks. And he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Sisters and brothers in Christ, Christ has set the table with more than enough for all. Come and let us eat. We sing together the Lamb of God.
Thank you.
Those that have communed via Zoom or by the communion packets, allow me to share the words with you. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, given and shed for you. And just a reminder to please dispose of remaining elements directly back to the earth. If the congregation then would please stand. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen. And may the blessing of God, who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us, be upon you now and forever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our closing hymn then is hymn number 575. Sisters and brothers in Christ, go in peace. You are the body of Christ. Thanks be to God. We will. Oh, thank you. Thank you.
tell you one thing, he's shitting better. Roger. I can't stay.